that. It's all about a man who knows exactly what It's Showtime is all about.
He was like Elvis. He's just like Elvis.
They both love it with death.
Pretty much so.
As I always say to him, open the fridge door and the light was on and you do 20 minutes.
Showbiz is supposed to be full of people that go into rehab, they're getting cocaine addicts, heroin. Johnny is a tea addict.
He's a national treasure, isn't he?
Johnny Beattie rocks. He is Scotland.
Glasgow Citizens Theatre, the audience is gathered to celebrate Johnny Beattie's 60 years in show business with a special gala in which a cast of family and friends pay tribute to one of Scotland's best-loved entertainers.
Everybody just rolled up the sleeves. Nobody was giving it, I have to be particularly looked after because I'm very, very precious and, you know.
And this is an amazing sort of labour of love that she's done this whole evening for him. It's lovely.
Everyone was just there for two purposes. One was to honour the wonder that is John Gerard Beattie, and the other one was to raise this money for charity.
The stars in the hazy heavens tremble.
This was a nostalgic evening of variety theatre. Alan Cumming reprised Johnny's Buttons from Cinderella, and Peter Morrison wrote a special ditty.
Down with the loutish vandals who scribble their graffiti. Bah to the social network, so twittery and tweety. Give me a Lear and Hamlet, or any role that's meaty. But let me find a legend to compare with Johnny Beattie.
Johnny himself stepped out onto the stage.
I know what some of you think. What is it doing with that suit? Ladies and gentlemen, this is the first suit I wore on May the 19th, 1952. That's 60 years last night. I haven't worn it for must be 50 years. I mean, this suit's older than my gags.
Una McLean revived the spirit of music hall as Doris Droy, a part she played in a show with Johnny 30 years ago.
I'm Sue, I'm just plain Sue. They call me Suicide Sal.
Absent friends sent tributes.
I'm always proud and pleased to see someone from the Govan Parish doing so well in life. I know you're from a different century from me, but dinosaurs live on.
Johnny, I love you, and 60 years well spent, and 60 years that the Scottish people will never get back again.
Fellow River City actor Tom Urey sang a Glasgow song for this boy from Govan.
In the second city of the empire, Mother Glasgow watches all her wings, trying hard to feed her little starlings. Unconsciously, she clips their little wings. the flightless birds and sightless starlings. Father Glasgow knows.
Down the Clyde, where Glasgow becomes Shield Inch in BBC soap River City, another day's filming is getting underway.
Wouldn't be the same without a wee cup of tea.
No, it certainly wouldn't. Start your day well.
Every day I come in, the girls make me a cup of tea. What can I say?
After his cup of tea, Johnny usually goes over lines with fictional wife Eileen McCallum.
Right, sir, what are we going to do? Because we don't speak to each other in this scene.
I think Liz might be quite anxious with Dan going away because he's been living in the house,
right.
He's been helping with your condition.
Yeah, and being a doctor, obviously, that's made it
exactly,
a bit special.
Exactly.
Johnny has played the character Malcolm Hamilton since the very first episode, 10 years ago.
So that's all out?
That's all out, Johnny. So the scene will start with Adam saying good luck. Liz nods, Dan turns to Malcolm, puts out his hand. Malcolm shakes it.
Oh, well, Malcolm.
Just at that moment, Magdalene will come running down the stairs from Molly's flat.
Dan, I'll miss you.
Could be a pickup at, as this morning was 8:30, I think, and it could have gone on till 7 o'clock. You see, so it's a long day.
I know.
The agent would be horrified to know how many times he is called for that length of time. But at one point, they brought a great big sofa bed thing in, and he was horrified. He said, I don't need that.
Got this air of, what do you call it, is it a patrician, you know, River City, the older actor, you know.
Yes.
When you're sitting in the canteen and people are talking about stories and things that they've done in their life, and then you get Johnny, you know, and Johnny will start talking about playing golf with people like Bob Hope. He's arguably the most entertaining person on here.
He's not going to the moon, woman.
At least he would be safer there.
He just always is such a true professional. He comes on and he nails his character, he nails his scene, he nails his lines.
When you see Johnny coming on the screen, you know you're going to get something good.
Look after yourself, son.
The biographer came to see me in the first week or so and said, Johnny, yeah? You're from Fife, you're a Fifer. You worked in a railway, you had to retire early for some kind of health reason, you know what I mean? And you've come over to the West of Scotland. I said, hold on a wee minute. Why am I a Fifer? You know, I was born and brought up in Govan.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want in the railway. I worked in the shipyards. Yes, she said.
Oh, no, that's
the way to do it.
Johnny's real life collided again with Malcolm's when a storyline involved memories of National Service in Malaya.
I said to a director, I was actually in Malaya in 1945 in the Royal Marines.
Yeah.
He said, have you any pictures? I said, yeah. So I brought in the following day a picture of the seven of us in Singapore.
Yeah,
seven
yeah.
And they used that. So it's art imitates life, you know, or life imitates art.
Absolutely.
Malcolm Hamilton.
Johnny's dementia story, I think, is important. It's an important story to tell. I think a lot of people are affected by that in families, and I think he's played it wonderfully well.
Look at me, Malcolm.
Take you, Elizabeth Buchanan, to be my lawful wedded wife.
It's quite strange when you see him doing, like, the Alzheimer's stuff, where he's supposed to look like he's sort of wandering a wee bit, whereas Johnny himself is just sharp as a tack.
I think, in a sense, he always was a frustrated actor. So now it's all turned full circle. Now he's doing what he always wanted to do, and good luck to him.
Yeah.
You know, as Johnny says, that's his pension.
I was going up by his road one day, two wives, this is a couple of years ago, two wives, they said, oh, Johnny, we're saying, I don't say. I said, you enjoying it? Seeing you a little funnier.
And the tree, and the fish, and the bird, and the bell. Let Glasgow flourish.
business was never a likely career for a working-class Glasgow boy in the 1930s. Johnny was clever, though, and there were high hopes for a professional career.
I was told I was going to be a teacher.
Oh, yeah.
And after the third year, instead of going back, I got a job as an errand boy in a cooperative. And I get quite pleased with the money, the tips money, and all that. So I didn't
I bet
go back.
You got great tips.
Oh, yeah.
Because you were doing the old patter with the wifeys. Oh, I can imagine it. So you went to the shipyards for your apprenticeship, and from there you went into the Marines.
That's right.
And that must have been an absolutely massive culture shock, the boy forgiven, to suddenly find himself in these incredibly exotic places.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
That must have been extraordinary.
Well, we landed first in Ceylon, and we were a month there, and then we moved to Singapore, you know. And fortunately, en route there on the boat, the Japanese surrendered. I think they probably heard I was on my way. And
that's what it was.
And I might sing, you know. Say,
oh, no, he might give us the wedding of Jock Mackay.
Although
that was probably a bit early for the wedding of Jock Mackay. It hadn't quite happened in our wonderful lives up until that point.
We stayed in a place initially called Kurnagala, which was in the middle of the jungle. And there was a gate, but no fence round it. And we were assigned to guard the gate. Now, even then, I thought, what the hell am I doing guarding this gate? I'd be fine. You know, you just went along the road and walked in. It'd be about, just dawn was breaking, you know. And
hot and humid,
four,
I imagine.
About 4 o'clock
gosh.
In the morning, and I heard this noise, and I look, and there's an elephant coming along the road. I'm saying, halt, who goes there? Then he just ignored me. Halt,
well, of
who
course.
Goes there? And it just went past me, and there was one of the wee natives up in the front.
Yes.
And it was on its way, as we found out later, to another part of the jungle for timber clearing.
Yes.
They were trained.
Of course.
But he never even looked in my direction. I'm standing.
Really?
Back on Civvy Street, Govan, Johnny returned to Fairfield Shipyard and entertaining his co-workers until a chance encounter with the director of an amateur dramatic group changed his life.
He said, I wonder if he could help us, I said. We're putting on this play, and I remember the name, Dan Skeldian can't do it, he's got the flu, and it's not a big part, but it's next week, could anyone come along? And I thought, oh, wait a wee minute, you know, Govan boy, you know, ex-Marine, get
of
me,
course.
Jack a lad, ha, ha, ha. And I looked at the girls, and I thought, quite nice, by the way. So I said, oh, okay, I'll come along. And I played this a police sergeant in a play called Grand National Night.
Yeah.
And then I gradually get bigger parts. I finished up playing the male lead, you know.
Of course. You played a lot of villains, didn't you?
Oh, nearly all. Oh, and Burke. I played Burke in Burke and Hare.
Oh.
Johnny's acting talents were starting to make quite an impression.
Tall, ramrod straight, mischievous, twinkly blue eyes. And he's very, very attractive to wee older women. Big ones too, of course. I mean, you know, all shapes and sizes. The man's a sort of babe magnet.
Beautiful head of jet black hair, and he had a kind of American gangster look about him.
And he never looked a comic. He wasn't a man that you looked at and said, oh, that's a funny man, because he looked a good-looking guy.
But Johnny was funny and formed a comedy duo with friend Wally Butler, and they played at concert parties until Wally landed Johnny an unexpected billing.
I picked up the Evening News, and there was the show business correspondent was called Mamie Crichton, and she said, so-and-so, College Pudding, principal comedian this year will be electrical engineering student John Beattie. So, I mean, we didn't have the phone, so I went in the subway, of course, and up the stairs to it. I said, what's this, Wally? What are we talking about? Because he'd asked me to write material,
yeah.
Because they hadn't come on. He said, well, you know, I'm stuck, and if you're writing the material, you may as well do it. So I went on and I did it, and there wasn't a bad audience that particular night.
Anyone who worked in the yards, and you think of Johnny, you think of Billy Connolly, for example, they will always tell you that if you could hold your own in the shipyards with your mates, you could entertain anybody.
The shipyards, they were like comedy workshops. I don't know when they get time to build boats. Because the patter went all day long, you know. And I remember one particular day I got bold and I said to an old boy in the yard beside me, I said, Sandy, we're doing a show in the South Government Town Hall. When you want to come tomorrow, maybe bring your wife. So he came in on Sunday night, and on a Monday, I committed the cardinal sin. You never say to people that you enjoy the show. If they enjoy the show, they tell you. If no, they talk about the weather or the football. And I said, Sandy, did you enjoy the show? And he looked at me. He said, there's better turns in the eye infirmary.
Johnny left Fairfields and turned professional after being spotted by Scottish tenor and international star Robert Wilson.
He asked me to come to Broxburn and do a Sunday night concert with him, which I did.
A wee tryout, obviously.
Just a wee tryout. And after it, he says, not too bad. I say, would you like to come and do some shows with me? I said, when are they, Mr. Wilson? He said, well, we start on the 5th of May. What could do? I said, I get married on the 3rd of May. Well, what is it? This is a tourist today. You be going on a honeymoon? Oh, yeah. Well, you can join me in a fortnight. And we did 6 months all over Scotland.
Gosh, what a great
Northern
start,
Ireland.
Dad.
Yeah, I was getting at least three times the money I had in the ship. Yeah. I was being paid £15 a week.
This newfound wealth reflected the popularity of variety shows, which played to huge audiences in the pre-TV world of 1952.
Well, really, at the time it was thriving. It was the only place you could go to get a laugh and a sing-song.
I would be on stage, maybe, say, in a gypsy scene, singing a song, street song, and singing about a gypsy, and then come off, get changed and quick, and I could be on as an old woman within about 3 minutes with the grey wig and the long black dress and the shawl and doing a sketch. And then the next time I could be on doing a double with Johnny. That's what variety was all about. There was a little bit of everything.
These summer seasons were four and a half months, twice nightly. Change a programme every week for about 6 weeks, then back to the original programme.
For us as a family, you know, you were very absent, simply because that's where the job was. And you know, there weren't motorways. In the very early days, you didn't have a car. And when you were up in Aberdeen, say, doing a summer season, you weren't getting back home, you couldn't. And then we would come and join you for the summer holidays. That must have been quite hard for you, being away from us all.
Very hard, very hard. But that's one of these things you have to do. I mean, you want to give you all a good start, a nice home and all the business, you know. And that was show business.
Gags, songs and sketches have come and gone in Johnny's acts over the last 60 years. But one or two favourites have remained constant.
Oh, just get from the wedding, oh, Mr. Joe Mackay.
He got married to a little girl, his name was Nellie Bly.
Make no mistake about it, it was quite a swell affair. Listen for a minute, and I'll tell you who was there. There was Mary.
I noticed that when he's doing a wedding of Jock Mackay, he finishes every time on a top F sharp, which is pretty impressive for a man who seems to have had no vocal training of any kind whatsoever. But his voice was kind of honed in the kind of back streets of Govan, as you know, so he didn't have to bother too much.
As a variety performer in ever-changing programmes, Johnny was always thinking of new ways to describe his act.
And I did a sketch of Romans. And dear old Bruce McClure, who was the top producer, he said, I've just seen this programme back. What's this here, your Roman sketch? Et tu, Beatty. I said, well, you know, Et tu, Brutus, Julius Caesar. What? What's that got to do with sketch? I said, OK, make it Roman in the gloaming.
I had a friend that was very good at making costumes. So I said to Johnny, I've got a... Why don't we do, like, a couple of cigarette packets, you know? It's another thing you couldn't do now. We came out and did cigarette gags. It didn't do well at all. I said to Johnny, I'm sorry about that, Johnny. This was all my idea to do that. Ah, never mind. God loves a trier.
If I was to say something on stage to him, not scripted, and it got a laugh, when we come off stages, the first person to say that was great and keep that in. Now, I've worked with lots of comics where I've said something and it's got a laugh and they've said to me afterwards, by the way, don't do that again. Just the difference. Johnny, doesn't matter who gets a laugh as long as the audience is laughing.
So Johnny liked a funny man with him, you know, and he gave you gags to do, which was very generous. It wasn't just a straight man, you know.
I do a particular character with him, and she's in a knitted dress.
Hello, hello, Ethie. Hello, hello.
I'm no here about myself, Ethie. I'm no here about myself.
Ethie, I'm here about my boyfriend. Ethie, I'm here about my boyfriend.
Have you got a boyfriend?
Oh, yeah.
Nothing matter with him. Nothing matter with him.
Here. Would you like to meet him, Ethie? Would you like to meet him?
I might as well. I'm doing nothing else. I'm stunned here waiting on a bus.
Well, he's got him in me here, so you stand there and he'll be here any minute and I'll introduce you to him because he's an awful nice fella. Oh, there he is there. Sebastian, come on and meet the nice man. Come on. Oh, come on, Sebastian. He's off a CI, so he's off a CI.
I can't even remember who won Britain's Got Talent last year. I might remember this year because of the dancing dog, but it's impossible to think of anyone going on to having that kind of rich and varied career. And it was highly improbable for Johnny to have imagined it, but it's a great tribute to his skill that he's achieved it evidently effortlessly.
We was always all together, all together, all the time. We was always all together, all the time. My father and my mother and my sister and my brother. We was always all together, all the time. Yippee!
Scottish acts were always in demand in Canada and North America, and Johnny regularly toured with the hugely successful Alexander Brothers, taking in halls from Vancouver to Medicine Hat to New York.
Well, the Carnegie Hall, I remember that one. We were all so excited, first time ever.
See, I mean, he's a real handsome guy, isn't he? When you look at him. Yeah, Johnny went down very, very well. You know, his topical gags and, you know, the New Yorkers were on the ball.
In the spring, when the world was young then, and the sweet songs of youth were sung then, by the Lord's side I met a maiden, and my heart longed to call her mine. She was fairer than words could say, man, and her smile made the world a gay man. But like springtime, she could not stay, man, though my heart longed to call her mine.
You know, when you tour Canada and America, they expect you
to wear the kilts.
To have the kilts on. That's part and parcel of the
Package.
The package.
Johnny always took his kilt off in the dressing room. One night between acts at the Ottawa Arts Centre, in shirt tails and his usual tartan boxer shorts, he got lost backstage.
Got to this door, opened it, walked through, it was very, very dimly lit, onto the stage in front of 300 people looking at him. He'd walked onto the set of...
Laughing at him, you know.
Hamlet. If you can imagine, the white hose, the Highland shoes, the boxer shorts, the shirt tail. So they must have thought that it was the ghost of Hamlet or whatever, you know. He raised his hand and just said, hello there, and walked off. They were halcyon days. We loved having him on the tours, that's for sure.
Well, it was great fun, great fun.
Who needs to go to New York State when you can rap in the Gallowgate?
Who needs to go to New York State when you can rap in the Gallowgate? Out in the street, punters all clapping. Hey, look at me, actually, Glasgow rapping. Oh, hey, the Glasgow...
The Glasgow Rap was Johnny's moment as a pop star when it shot straight into the Scottish charts at number 15.
No, that was in the mid-80s or something, and he was taking, you know, urban black music and giving it a Glasgow slant. I thought that was fantastic.
Get loud, they belt it out. Rubbing a
I mean, I did a concert with Johnny about a month ago, and people were all shouting, "Geez, a Glasgow rap, geez," and he did it.
See, you, Jimmy, you're a right wee brammer. Hard luck, Cecil, can he talk the grammar? Glasgow rapping, you just shout well, geez, a break, then go on yourself. Glasgow rapping, just pure magic. Bulls in the moon, is that no tragic?
It's very good. Eminem is worried, you know.
I wouldn't have to remember the Glasgow rap. Johnny will do you a rendition of the Glasgow rap at the drop of a hat. I've heard it in the canteen, I've heard it in the corridor, I've heard it at home, I've heard it by road.
Performing solo and with feeds like John Mulvaney, Hector Nickel, Anne Fields and Russell Lane, Johnny always wrote much of his own material and developed his own kind of comedy.
Johnny joke. Wee boy went to a shoe shop, he's got a pair of shoes, he tried them on, he said they're too tight, the woman said try them in the tongue, he did that tight.
Johnny has a flypaper memory. It's a remarkable thing. He can't just tell you where he was or which theatre he was in 1962. He'll tell you who was in the cast, what costumes they wore, what the tea lady wore and all sorts of stuff.
Johnny Beattie, you have 2 minutes on corny one-line jokes, starting from now. Drink.
Edinburgh man says to the Glasgow man, "Where's the nearest boozer?" He says, "You're talking to him." Man suffered from alcoholic constipation. He couldn't pass a pub. Man driving the wrong way up a one-way street. A policeman says, "Where are you going?" He says, "I don't know, but it can't be up to much. They're all coming back from it."
Doctors.
Doctors. The old maid went into the doctor, rushed out 2 minutes later screaming. And the nurse said to the doctor, "What happened?" He said, "I've just told that old maid she's pregnant." The nurse said, "Is she?" He said, "No, but it's cured her hiccups."
At his 40th celebration of whatever it was, he said, "I'm going to do 40 gags in 10 minutes. And he did 40 gags in 10 minutes. And then when he was doing his 50th, he said, "I'll do 50 gags in 10 minutes. And he just reels them all off, you know. And he's a gag man.
Landladies.
I said, "May I have an alarm clock?" She says, "You won't need an alarm clock. You'll hear me scraping the toast. The sheets in the bed were damp." I said, "I'll have lumbago in the morning." She says, "You'll have porridge like everybody else."
Shopkeepers.
Shopkeepers. Lady walked into the butcher shop. She says, "Have you got sheepseed?" He said, "No, it's just a way of part my hair." She said, "You keep dripping." He says, "Mind your own damn business." Man walked into the fishmonger, but a chamber pot up in the counter. He says, "A pound of fillet." He says, "A pound you don't."
A lot of humour is sort of kind of mean, and he's not. So, yeah, he's kind of unusual in that way, I think.
His humour is incredibly warm. I think it's not cynical in any way. It's absolutely about a kind of positive humour and about finding the kind of sweetness and the emotional thing in something. I also think he's very dry, so it's not a sentimental humour in any way at all. But it's a kind of sophisticated and a polite humour. He's a kind of gentleman comedian, if there is such a thing.
If I could absorb an iota of his charisma and his stagecraft, it would make me 5,000 times a better comedian.
They've got studs in their eyebrows, in their ears, their nose, through their lips, in their tongue. I'll not go any further doing, but they've got them there. They've covered metal studs. I mean, gentlemen, when we were at that age, to attract a young lady, you just need a wee bit of charm, personality. Nowadays, to attract a lassie, you just need a big magnet.
I took my granny, who was a great Johnny Beattie fan, hurt to see him one night. It was in the Pavilion. I'll never forget this as long as I live. I remember buying a paper, an Evening Times, and there was a story in it. And he told a gag about this thing that was in the Evening Times. And I think I might have been the only one that laughed because it was too new.
And he'd say to Anne Fields, "I don't understand that. You know, how are doing these gags and no laughs there?" She says, "Well, where did you? I've never heard that." He said, "It's in the papers, in the Evening Times." She said, "Johnny, that first house audience, they probably even haven't bought the Evening Times, or if they have, they haven't read it."
An admiration for Scottish comedians like Tommy Morgan, Dave Willis, and Lex McLean from a previous generation shows that up to date Johnny still had a foot in the past.
They say married men live longer than single men. It's a lie, it just seems longer. If I don't stay in at night, I'm not a home bird. If I stay in, I'm a pest. If I go home early, she thinks I'm after something. And if I go home late, she thinks I've had it.
Clyde Banks' Lex McLean, known as Sexy Lexi for his often risque humour, was, like Johnny, a graduate of the shipyards. Joni is a talented mimic who has recreated Lex McLean's comedy on stage.
There's your hero.
The greatest!
Robbie Buns, a big waster. Wrote daft wee songs and silly poemetries. And she's kept them hidden.
Yes, he was a success in every field he went in.
I mean, he makes the hair in the back of my neck stand up with some of the voices. If he sneaks up on you and does Lex McLean, you go, oh, no, it can't be. No, he's dead.
He just has never forgotten where he came from, which is, to me, a great thing in any human.
Sadly comedy now, especially the stand-ups nowadays, the talking comics, I mean, a lot of them are funny, but okay, I'm old-fashioned, but I just think some of them go too far. You didn't have that kind of stuff, you know, these great comics, you know, the Tommy Coopers and the Morecambe and Wises.
Absolutely, it's all from the same tradition, yeah.
Oh, they were riotously funny without sitting telling guys about all things they shouldn't even be talking. That's me. God.
My idea of hell would be to be in a room full of comedians. Because they're all, you know, because they all try to top each other, and they're actually all, you know, it's all kind of a little crazed and a little sort of scientific. Actually, it's not very fun. It's all about science and why did that gag work and why did this one and why did that, you know, why? And so, but Johnny, I would like to be in hell with Johnny. That'd be quite fun. But you know, I don't think he's got that. He doesn't have that gene. And I think it's perhaps because his whole thing is about warmth and openness. It's not about sort of, you know, cunning and meanness in his humour.
I'm just going to tell you a little story that will tie in with Johnny's kind of sense of humour. I had a lady in the hospice and she was crying. I said to her, what's wrong? Why are you so upset? And she said, sister, she said, I know I'm dying. And she said, I was married to a wonderful man. We were so happy. And I said, isn't that wonderful? And she said, yes, but she said, he died when I was in my 30s. I met a wonderful man again, and she said, I got married. My God, I said, I don't believe it, that you met two wonderful men. And she said, what will I do when I get to the other side? Listen, I said, if I know anything about men, they'll have already found somebody else.
Sister Rita is the chief executive of the St Margaret of Scotland Hospice in Clydebank. The proceeds of the gala will benefit the hospice, where Johnny is valued as a generous supporter.
The ladies' lunch is very special because it is all ladies, except for one man, and that's Johnny. He loves to be the centre of attention there because the women just love him. And he has taken part in the fashion shows and he's very entertaining. The Christmas party is a very special occasion. And Johnny comes to that and he really brightens the whole thing up because there is a great sadness about it. You know, a lot of patients and their families are very aware that that's their last Christmas. It's not as though he turns up for the ball and the big things. He turns up for the small things that are very precious and special to patients. And I think that that's what I have such respect for him. To be able to sort of pick up the phone and just speak to Johnny himself, you know, is absolutely tremendous. You know, sometimes with other people you have to go through layers and layers, but not with Johnny. You can speak directly to him, and that's what I admire most about him.
I've genuinely never known Johnny to say no. I've seen him standing in the middle of soggy parks to open pensioners' active open days. I've seen him going along to the hospice just to pop in and say hello and have a cup of tea, which is one of his favourite pastimes as well.
At his gala, Johnny Beattie, MBE, became an ambassador of the Variety Club. He's a keen supporter of charities related to the entertainment industry. Perhaps not surprising after 60 years in show business. Johnny once played Broadway and Cowdenbeath in the same week. But the place he regards with most affection is the Gaiety Theatre in Ayr. As he says, he's been to Ayr that many times, he's starting to look like Robbie Buttons.
I just fell in love with the theatre with the word go. Yeah. I just, well, it's, well, you know, the first time you played it, darling.
I have, it's a wonderful.
It's this intimacy that I've never, I mean, I've spoken to people, big names, and they say, oh, a theatre.
If you got the Getty, well, you were something, you know.
Well, it was a great run, a great season.
Classy, it was a classy theatre.
Mr. Getty, that's what they called John.
First time I came to the Gaiety, there was an enormous billboard, and it said, the Gaiety Air, the family theatre run by a family for the family. And that could appeal to me, you know.
As principal comedian in the Gaiety whirl, Johnny was at the top of his game. He also relished a uniquely informal atmosphere.
There was never a stage doorman at that theatre, oddly enough, unlike other theatres. People would wander in, hello there, come into your room for a chat in the middle of a show. You're rushing about. And Johnny would be there, he'd be changing, and there'd be a man in talking about the theatre, an old designer guy talking about the sets and how the theatre's changed. That's right. And Johnny was too mannerly to say, I'm busy. So he'd be chatting to him, getting into a kilt outfit all the time. And also, over the course of the night, checking, looking over about 15 bits of paper with people who were in. Wally and Agnes are in their 24th wedding anniversary, because he would refuse to go on and read it from notes. Memorise them all, every night.
Whirl probably describes the atmosphere backstage at variety shows pretty well, with all the costume changes for sketches, comedy routines, dance numbers and songs.
So, I mean, you can imagine, we're up to high dough, especially at the change of programme on a Monday. And Johnny, cool hand Johnny Beattie.
Cool handed look.
He would just go in and lock his door in the dressing room.
Fall asleep.
And fall asleep.
They loved my wife's soup. He used to say, has Lil made soup? I said, yes.
Johnny's predecessor as principal comic at the Air Gaiety was Jack Mulroy, famous later with Ricky Fulton as Glasgow's comedy teddy boys, Francie and Joseph.
Oh, it was brilliant, Joseph, but Joseph, it was brilliant. I mean, mind the old days, mind all the wee shops would be here, the wee Jenny O things.
The Jenny O things. Now, you could get anything in there, but a needle to an oil rig. Do you remember
Joseph,
that?
True.
I'll tell you what, let's show them what it was like, eh?
Sure, Joseph,
I'll be in the shop, you'll be a customer.
Right. I'm coming into the shop.
You're coming into the shop,
right. Hey, ding, ding, good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like a pair of crocodile shoes.
Certainly, what size is your crocodile take?
I'm in the shop,
right. Hey, ding, ding. Good morning.
Oh, my God, good morning.
Good morning. Only honey.
No, honey, only.
Before Francie and Josie, Jack had been headlining solo at the Gaiety for 5 years. Johnny took over in 1959, and they became lifelong friends.
And there was a real rite of passage. There was a... Jack gave him a gold watch, which was passed on as an indication that he had finally made it, and the apprenticeship was over.
You know, he talks about Jack Mulroy with huge fondness, and he tells me all the time that Jack used to just say every day to him, oh, we're awfully lucky. Oh, we're awfully lucky. Oh, we're blessed, you know. And Johnny mimicked that a lot, and you can just see that's a sentiment that he really, you know, holds with too, and you really get that from Johnny, that sense of delight at his fortune.
They used to go in once a year for a week to the Pavilion. I used to say to Johnny, "You'd be about 80 then," and I'd say to him, "You're no needing the money. What the hell are you getting there for? Well, you're no need." Mary, I used to say, "I love it. I love getting to Johnny. He brings in the tea and he brings in the biscuits, and we have the best laugh. And if anybody's singing a sad song, we listen to them and we say, 'Oh my, it's so sad. Oh, it's so sad.'" And the two of them laughed their head off. And as they walked out, they used to say, "The legends have left the building."
In the early 70s, Johnny's beloved Gaiety Theatre was under threat of demolition to make way for a supermarket. It was reprieved after a campaign spearheaded by Johnny.
Yeah, I say every night, you've been a marvellous audience. You were well worth saving the Gaiety for, and it gets a standing ovation. It really does.
But the Gaiety went dark again in 2009, with the real possibility that it might never open its doors again. Johnny was as outraged as he was the first time and addressed a public protest meeting.
They turned up in their hundreds. Yes. They took in the local church, 700-seater, standing room, only people outside.
Of course.
Wouldn't you think they would get some kind of message? No, and somebody say, oh, I could lose his money. It's not there to make money. It's a tourist amenity, a social amenity. It's a civic amenity. Yep. And you still get that group.
It's extraordinary.
Who just can't get their head round it.
No, it's almost like it becomes a kind of a, we are not going to be moved. It becomes about not being moved as opposed to thinking sensibly and listening to all the arguments about
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely.
You know.
Who knows whether the Gaiety will ever whirl again, but the trust now responsible for the theatre will reopen the doors this year for audiences to enjoy that last of truly traditional family entertainments, the pantomime.
Your tannoy is crackling off the wall. You can hear all the buzz. The curtain opens as Neil Beyond says, everybody cheers. They haven't even seen us. And we go on and do all the business and audience participation. Oh, no, you don't. Oh, yes, you do. Oh, so. And I've often think, you could almost prescribe that in the National Health. Never mind, Bills. Give them a couple of tickets for a good pantomime.
Absolutely.
You know, that kind of, so that. And no matter how tired you are when you're doing a pantomime, you just get that lift right away, you know.
This is the crack unit, the SES. The Saltoke Athletic Society.
You may have had a bad day or whatever, and you're suddenly sitting there with, 1,000 other people who are terribly disparate people and have come from all over the place, and they may have had a really shocking day, or some have had a happy day, and they are all sitting together in a theatre, and Johnny Beattie's on stage, and you just go, whoosh. And I think he can capture an audience in the palm of his hand and do what he wants with them.
You did that fabulous Rodgers and Hammerstein Cinderella. Was that at the Empire?
Glasgow Empire.
That was
1960, I think it was, yeah.
That was fabulous.
Oh, that was wonderful.
Did you love that?
Oh, I loved doing that, yeah.
Johnny was Buttons, and he was a very good Buttons, actually. He was a very good Buttons. It was a lovely, lovely show. And it was the very last show to be in the Empire. So Johnny and I said, we closed the Empire.
The stars in the hazy heavens tremble above you as he is whispering, darling, I love you.
So how did you feel when you saw Alan coming? I mean, that must have been a huge surprise, because I know you knew Alan was in the show, but you didn't know he was going to be doing that.
It just blew me away. The big thing that blew me away, too, was the fact that who's playing Cinderella, but my 60-year-old grandniece.
Well, Alan was thrilled to be asked, and he was loved because he's been a huge fan of yours for, you know, for
long
enough.
Fancy Alan coming, but a fan of mine, eh?
Well, there you go.
The straight role of Buttons in Cinderella at the Glasgow Empire Theatre was the last time Johnny appeared in pantomime as anything other than the Dame. For the next 30 years, he was centre stage, decked out in wigs and frocks, and truly in his element.
Some dames you go to see, it's like a mannequin parade, you know. I think Danny LaRue made a career out of it. Stanley Baxter's made a career out of it as well. Very clever and all that. But with Johnny Beattie, it was funny. When he come onto the stage, everybody in that theatre knew, that's a man dressed up as a woman. And that's the way it should be in a pantomime dame. You don't want the kids thinking, it's a strange-looking woman with an Adam's apple.
It's like when you see women standing at the bus stop having a chat with each other, and it's that kind of gallus kind of way that they speak to each other with that kind of, oh, I know, I told you that that's what he said to me, I told you about that. And it's that kind of wonderful way that he mimics women, a particular type of gallus Glasgow woman, without being insulting. He's not insulting them. He's not making fun of them. He's just being them.
He was Sadie Sinbad, and I was the Sultana of Baghdad. Baghdad, Baghdad, it's a wonderful town. And we had this wonderful scene where we were shipwrecked, and we thought we were landing on this island, and it was just a big humplet in the middle of the slate, and it was very, very shiny, and there was supposed to be indents in it for us to climb up. Well, they hadn't made the indents, but it turned out it was a whale. It was a whale, you know, trying to get onto this thing. And I got to know a great deal about Johnny Beatty, I can tell you. Grabbing here, grabbing there. And the place was in an uproar. And I remember I had a counsellor by the neck that night. And, you know, they wouldn't change it. It was so funny, they kept it. And so every night was different, but every night was very funny. And people used to say, oh, I was in the night when you couldn't get onto the whale. Little did they know it was every night. It was a lovely wee hotel that Johnny and I went to and had a few drinks. And then they always kept us a nice supper. And so that was when I really, you know, you get to know somebody when you're as close as that. And he was a great, a lovely companion to be with. And you knew he was never going to try any funny business. You know what I mean? An honourable man.
Johnny was great to me by bringing me along, letting me come into his pantomime. I did three or four pantomimes with Johnny, and I did three or four summer seasons with Johnny, and I learned so much just being with him. You know, just being with people like that. You know, you can't learn that. You can't learn that going to college, you know. But nowadays the kids all go to college and learn how to become an actor or how to become a comic or how to become a singer. And in those days, I didn't get that training. I never had that training. I had to watch people like Johnny and learn from them.
Here we are, boys and girls, the original Flues of the Forest. Oh, we're wearing the Beech Grove collection. My name is Pansy Potter, and I'm Jesse, the Fluid of Blaine. We're going to go environmental. Yes, environmental. I'm environ and she's mental.
That ability to be able to use your voice and to be able to go right to the back of the room and for everybody in every corner to be able to hear you, to get every moment, to get the timing, all of those things. You know, that's what Laurence Olivier had, that's what the great actors have. And Johnny Beatty has that in absolute spades.
It was funny when he played the Panto Dame in River City. We had such a laugh about that because we had to keep reminding him he was meant to be Malcolm, so therefore he'd be rotten at it. But he was so in his element, you know, with these kind of Madonna boobs.
River City has introduced Johnny to a new generation of TV viewers, but many still remember earlier TV incarnations.
He really has been someone that I've always known in my life. You know, from Welcome to the Kaylee.
I wrote the opening song for that.
Welcome to the Kaylee. Come in, come in, come in.
Very good. I remember it quite well.
The royalties weren't all that good, but still.
You need a good pair of hurdies for the kilt. Don't you? And people always say how well you wear the kilt.
Well, I think the big sticky bums get a lot to do with it. It makes it kind of hang nicely.
I think that's right.
He's very handsome in his kilt, because he wears it well. Not every man can wear a kilt well, but Johnny wears it tremendously well.
Johnny's the army man, you know, and he walks like a grenadier guard, I always say. Johnny walks like the grenadier guards.
Johnny Beatty walk.
Shows like Welcome to the Kaylee had much in common with the old variety shows, but with a wee bit more tartan.
It was a surprise to many people that he took on the Grampian programme, the Welcome to the Kaylee. He fitted in very well. I took part in those programmes as well. And, yeah, he created a niche for himself there. Whatever he does it well. I've said to Johnny, Johnny, you keep turning up in my life. He said, I'm a professional turner-upper.
Now, you see it.
You know what it's like in New Year's? Celebrities are very hard to get. But there's magic in the air. Now you see them.
These things were great. They should do more of these things on the television now.
Line four, position one, thrust.
Oh, how about that?
Button and it didn't work.
A likely story. Listen, Johnny, he's just suffering for a bit of frostbite.
Can we have another
question, please. Thank you.
They're freeing up the daytime schedules, apparently. So I, for one, think Johnny Beattie should be back on my television with Now You See It. Absolutely. And I'll be one of the first contestants. As long as he wears a kilt.
Not knees, but bare knuckles featured in the movie of William McIlvany's The Big Man, with Johnny flexing his straight acting muscles in his film debut.
I'm beginning to sound like my mother. Everything she said about us, it's all true.
Sometimes you sound as if we'd brought you up as a punishment.
His role in the comedy drama The Sunshine Boys was a personal career highlight, and Johnny's mafia good looks were perfect for a shady character in Taggart.
I'm gonna have you.
You tried it once before, Mr. Taggart. Now tell me, what crime are you gonna make up for me this time?
As a matter of fact, Jack and I, we're about the only two in show business that didn't get a part in the Taggart. Everybody else did.
Daughter Maureen took him to a workshop at the Royal Shakespeare Company, where he caught the attention of renowned voice coach Cicely Berry.
That particular workshop, just as it happened, was about the relationship between King Lear and the fool character in Lear. And Cis, being Cis, suddenly went, "Oh, she's a Johnny, a comedian, aren't you?" And Dad went, "Yeah." She said, "Would you like to read the fool for us?" And Dad was, you know, a bit taken aback, but, you know, did what he always does, which is step up to the plate. And it was just an absolute sensation. And it, you know, all the actors were like, including me, because he got a laugh on every line, which is unheard of in Shakespeare's fools. You know, here am I, I've worked with the Royal Shakespeare Company umpteen times. I think of myself as, like, you know, a straight classical actress. And am I mentioned in any of Cicely Berry's books? No, but my father is.
Before his acting career took off again with River City, when he was a youthful 76, Johnny regularly hosted the Pride of the Clyde shows, which reprised that mix of variety and white heather.
That I saw Johnny live was at the Mitchell Theatre. He was doing a Pride of the Clyde type of show. And the audience were, they just weren't getting it. It was a Monday night show, First House Monday night. It's the worst. And God love him, Jack Mulroy and Mary Lee were in the audience, sitting about six rows back. And Johnny was working from the stage and getting nothing from the audience. And suddenly Jack started to feed him. Jack was feeding him lines from six rows back, and Johnny and Jack had this kind of, did this double act. Absolutely wonderful moment to see, again, these two great comedians, because Jack had passed it on to Johnny, to see this, still this rapport as they worked together, and it was just a little moment of theatre magic. After that show, when the audience had been less than cooperative, you would never have known from Johnny on stage, I went backstage to see him and I said, "How was it?" He said, "I'll tell you, Andy." He said, "See that mob tonight?" He said, "They just came in for spite."
Some audiences, though, are more appreciative than others.
Johnny made the most brilliantly funny speech at my wedding. It was hilarious. He's a very good after-dinner speaker as well. Very, very good.
And when Ronald Reagan was honoured by the Scotch whisky industry, Johnny got a call asking him to write the president's acceptance speech.
Thank you.
I said, "Come on, Ronald Reagan, I didn't even know he was over here."
No.
And he explained in detail. He says his entourage has written his acceptance speech and the Earl of Elgin has deemed it to be unsuitable.
Oh.
I said, "When do you want it for next week? Can we have it for 6 o'clock, he says."
Well done, Johnny Beattie. God, is that what happens? If Barack Obama comes, will I be asked to write a speech for him? It wouldn't be as good as Johnny's, I suspect.
When they landed in America, they were given a horse,
a plough, 10 acres of land,
and 2 tickets to Frank Sinatra's farewell concert.
¶¶ Growing up in Glasgow before the war, the highlight of Johnny's year was the annual trip to Rothsay, and he's been carrying on a love affair with the Isle of Bute ever since.
We used to come here on holiday in the Glasgow Fair fortnight, because as you know, the Glasgow Fair fortnight, I mean, the last 2 weeks in July, everybody went down the water, and so many of them came here to Rossi. There's a postcard here you'll see of seven steamers all round the pier. The promenade was chock-a-block. There would be the cornage leaning against the rail and the promenade, and they'd all be dancing, you know, fantastic. And the lights were, all the illuminations were up. This place here in the background, I used to come here and, you know, with my brother, and the summer show would be rehearsing there. And we could hear music and singing, and we used to jump up and try and see in the windows, which you couldn't do, you know. And maybe that put a wee notion in my head, I don't know. My parents would take us in for the summer show too, you know, and you'd see all the old comics, and it was just a great atmosphere. I mean, they do call it Scotland's Madeira, but I've got nothing but happy memories, and of course I have a place here now, and I come here whenever I can. It's just, it's my personal Shangri-La.
The first time ever I saw Johnny was in the Winter Gardens. I think I was about 12. He doesn't really like me reminding him about that all these years ago. He comes here to escape. He could float a boat on the tea that Johnny has drunk throughout his career.
The amazing thing about Johnny is that he seems to know everybody. It's not the other way around, where because he's the big star, people recognise him, but he's a well-kent face in Rothsay.
Johnny fought hard to save the Ayr Gaiety, and he was just as passionate about Rothsay's winter gardens when it too was threatened by the march of so-called progress.
When you approach that in a steamer, and you see that winter garden with the wee Chinese pagodas, and you think of your childhood and all that. Mm-hmm. Now, if that had been demolished, what would that? It would have extended the car park, lorries, buses.
The bulldozers were defeated after local laird Sir Richard Attenborough joined forces with campaigners and Johnny.
Yes! Oh, a ham to the end.
I want to get to know you, want to hear you say hello. I'm gonna shout out hidey hi and you shout honey ho. And we you, Johnny lad. I'll dance the buckles up a shout, everybody clap. And we you, Johnny lad. I'll dance the buckles up a shout, we you.